So next round. So Orla, do you want to say what you're doing? You're stunned, aren't you? So you're very dazed. Can you take off? What's your coordination?
My coordination is 3.
Okay. Let's have a look here. Yeah. So if you can take off 3 coordination points.
No, that needs to be no coordination.
That's right. So that's the nature of you being stunned at the moment. So you're not able. You're completely dazed, not aware of what you're doing.
Okay.
Doctor, what are you doing?
From the court of the previous queen we visited, I find in my pockets a gold coin.
Okay.
Which, how far away from the side man am I?
You are around about 4 metres or so away from it. Very near.
Right. So would I be close enough to be able to touch him with a gold coin?
If you run over to him, you would.
A sort of lunge away or a kind of proper run?
You've got to step up to him. It's 4 meters away, so it's not that far. But you've still got to cover the distance. He's not within arm's reach. Let's put it that way.
Okay.
But if you run at him, he will be.
I run at him, brandishing the gold coin in my hand, ready to press it against his chest plate to do the most damage there.
Sure. Okay. He is going to use his grip strength on you. And the two people on the floor are going to get up and they're going to start trying to strangle you, Doctor.
Because, just to let you know, for Nicola's benefit, sidemen are allergic to cold.
Ah.
On and off.
Well, yeah, earlier models are, like in the later models, they've got a slightly more resilient, but they still...
It's still a problem. Yeah, it's still a problem for them, absolutely.
It's not as deadly as it used to be, but still a problem, as per Neil Gaiman's episode, which you wrote, Nightmare and Silver.
And a very good episode it was as well.
I guess, yeah.
Okay, so you're spending this round running up to... you're spending part of the round running up to him. At the same time, these two humans are coming at you. They've both got their eyes closed, and they're trying to grab you. So are you trying to, as they run up, it's very difficult for you to get out of their way. So they're trying to grab you, to immobilise you. Okay. So can you roll coordination, please? Coordination plus fighting.
9 plus 11, so 20.
Yeah.
You roll, or you do every time?
No, that's just for that roll. You get those extra dice.
Yeah. Cool. Okay, you're able to dodge out of their way. They're really slow, shuffling along, and you're able to nip easily out of their grasp as you do so. So you're coming out of Cybermen. What's your coordination, Doctor?
My coordination is 5.
Okay. Roll. So you're trying to... can you describe to a bit more detail? Remind me what you're doing?
Well, I'm running towards the Cyberman with a gold coin in my hand, ready to put against his chest plate to try and shock his system.
Okay. You've got pockets trait, haven't you? If you look on your traits.
Yes. Pockets?
In the corner there with your glasses.
Oh, yeah, sorry.
Sorry?
There's too many traits.
No, you're right. It doesn't... No, I don't think your doctor actually has it. I think it's only some of them that do. So in that case,
I don't have any pockets.
I'll allow you to have a gold coin, a handy gold coin, in your pocket if you spend a story point.
Really?
Yeah.
I know I find the side men a lot, so I carry one with me. Fine, story point is then. I think that's mean, but okay.
That's what you can, with story points, you can get round problems as well, creatively.
So
it's not just a way of adding dice on to achieve things. Okay, so if you can do a fighting, coordination plus fighting roll, he, on the Cyberman sees you coming at him, and he's raised his great big maw like this to reach out to you, grab you around the neck. So, okay, so roll, please.
So I'm up to 9 plus 6. Oh, cool, 15. Just heard him mouthing the word crush. I'm sure this is going to work out well for me.
Sorry, what did you want?
15.
He's trying to reach out to you like this, but you're so quick, you're able to get under his grasp. And how does it work in terms of the gold? What do you do with gold coin?
Press it against his, the round chest plate in the centre?
As it does so, as it comes into contact, he stops for a moment like this and seems frozen in on the spot. And staggers to the floor. Okay. Meanwhile, the two humans are still coming at you, trying to grab you around the neck. What are you going to do? The sideman's frozen. As you're applying the gold coin to his chest, he's kneeling on the ground, frozen, groaning and grasping, and clawing the air with his hands ineffectually. But the humans, with their eyes closed, are still coming at you, trying to maul you.
I'm going to use my telepathy from underneath my traits.
Okay.
and psychic abilities to try and kind of like reach their minds to find out the mental state they're in, what's controlling them and what's happening there.
Okay. So
get a sense of anything.
Sure. Okay. Okay. So can you roll presence plus convince, please?
Presence 4 versus convince.
And you get an extra 2 points because of your telepathy, I'm going to say.
Say 10.
Okay.
13.
Yeah. You're really easily able to reach out into their minds to see what their situation is. And when you look into their minds are very blank and empty. But what you do feel is that their whole bodies are being taken over by a field of some form of energy that comes from the south. There's a point of energy in the south that is reaching out to their bodies and overwhelming them and forcing them to do what they're doing. So they have no choice. Their minds are completely unconscious in a very deep sleep state when they're doing this. That's it, really. There's no actual mind to. There's not much mind to reach out with telepathy.
I've got my next move then.
Right. Meanwhile, so they're still trying to grab you, and because you're holding this gold coin now down onto the sideman's chest while you're doing this, they're able to grab you, and they're starting to try and pull you around and push you around. Okay. What's your? Can you roll strength plus fighting, please?
Right. Strength is 2 now. Plus fighting 4, so 6.
Okay, roll.
No, 10.
You're just able to stand your ground. They are completely asleep, and their movements are really inaccurate and clumsy. And they're, although they've got hold of you, but it doesn't really seem to be doing a lot, these two people. Meanwhile, the two people who are driving the cart are still trying to do it. It just isn't working because the cart's broken. Okay, so next round. So what are you doing this round?
Okay, I'm going to use, remembering from all this that I've gathered about the thing to the south.
Yep.
And remembering that they were controlled by some, like, more susceptible to magnetism, as we found out earlier.
Yep.
I'm going to use the sonic screwdriver to create a magnetic pulse. See if I can disrupt the signal.
Okay.
Thinking maybe this is how it's all done.
Sure. Okay. The sideman has now, although he's in great pain, and he's still making that really awful sound. Thank you.
Like Jeff Banks. Jeff Banks is it the... No, Jeff... Something Banks from the... used to be the guy who played the sidemen in the Five Doctors when they get, like, you know, hit. They go... That's the noise I'm picturing.
Okay. He's grabbed... Although he's still doing that, with one arm, his hand has grabbed your arm. The arm that's holding the gold coin onto his chest. Okay? So what are you going to... That's what you're doing this round. He's going to try and remove your hand from his chest. Remove the gold coin from his chest. Okay? So you're doing your thing with your sonic. So while you're holding on, it's made extra difficult because some of your concentration is on holding this gold coin onto the sideman's chest. Okay? So if you can roll... ingenuity plus technology, please.
20.
Okay. With Sonic.
Yes.
You're able to create this momentary magnetic pulse, and with a effect, suddenly that knocks out this localized effect around these particular people, and they fall to the ground asleep. They're still alive, but they're just sleeping very heavily. Meanwhile, Sideman, grabbing your arm, trying to push it away. Right, what's your strength plus fighting, please?
Strength is 2 still at the moment, plus fighting is... So, 6.
Okay.
Plus roll the dice, yeah.
Yep.
8.
It goes... and flings you away.
Ow!
Okay, the Sideman gathers to his feet... And with a slow rumbling sound, he starts to lift off the ground. What are you doing?
Run for your life! So grab Orla by the hand.
Sure.
And try and run for it.
Okay, cool. The sideman lifts off and flies in the direction of the south, over the woods, over the forest, towards the south. Okay. Right, back to Nomi. So you're on this bed, rigid, your body held rigid, your whole consciousness taken over by this presence. What are you going to do?
I'm going to say that I'm in control of my body, and that something's got a hold of me. So, and I cannot do anything about it.
Okay. Are you trying to fight back against the presence at all, or are you allowing it to control you?
I'm trying to fight back. Trying to get past it so I can feel again.
Okay. Sure. Okay. So roll resolve plus presence, please. And I appreciate it's two attributes, but on occasion you can do this. And do remember you've got your story points as well.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. 13.
Although it's really hard work and you're sweating with the effort, you are able, ultimately, using your whole mental willpower to throw off this consciousness that's grabbed hold of you. And by trying to control your body, that works as the focus for you to be able to get rid of this presence in your body. And you're able to get control again. Okay, so you're really hot and you're completely exhausted from the effort of doing that. But you are ultimately able to rid yourself of the presence, and you're back in action against once more. But there's a guard leaning over you saying, "Son, are you all right? What's up with you, mate?" It's the same one that you bewildered with your terminology earlier. You talk gibberish, mate, but are you all right?
Yeah, I'm okay now.
I thought you were just having a fit. I really did. I thought the devil himself had got you.
No, something had taken over my whole entire body.
Oh my God. What was it?
I'm not quite sure.
I see. So you're having a chat with him when suddenly you hear a ah! From a higher level in the castle. Scream that rings out in the castle.
What was that? Let's go find out.
It's a female voice as well.
Let's go check if it's the queen.
Okay. So you're running, scarpering across the corridor, along the corridors of the castle, up some stairs towards where the queen's chambers are. And it seems to be coming from the lady-in-waiting's chamber. So, inside you can hear, "Get off! Get off it! Get it off me, quick! Oh my God, get it off me!" What do you do?
God, save her.
Okay, the guard that you're with rushes into the room, and in the doorway, the guard has run in. You can see from the doorway that in the there's a candlelight that's able to show you some of what's inside. You can see that there is a... it's Mary Seton, the lady-in-waiting of the Queen of Scotland. She's holding something that's at her neck. She's got some... It's very difficult to see from the angle that you're in. It's very dark in the room, but she's holding something against her neck. Get it off! Get it off! What'd you do?
Try to pull it off of her.
Okay, so you run up to her. On her neck, it looks like a really large rat or a hedgehog made of silver. Is all you can see in the moonlight, in the candlelight. And it seems to be biting. Two metallic fangs going into her neck.
I've seen one of those before. And they're not that nice. Trust me.
I trust you! Just get it off me!
I'm not sure how to get it off of you. It's, like, really stuck on.
Ah, she's fallen on the floor.
It's, like, biting really hard and is stuck on, like, really deep.
Yes, it is! And then it gets off. It unplugs itself, effectively, from her body, and it's now crawling along the floor of the room.
Quick, stop it.
One of the guards, he's got his spear, and with the blunt end of the spear, he's trying to hit it like this. Trying to thud it with the end of the spear. But it's just too agile, it's too mobile. He can't do it. He can't actually hit it.
Try using your implants.
I'll try and use my implants.
Okay, so you activate your interface, and you're trying to reach out to the circuitry of this creature, whatever it is. Okay, do an ingenuity plus technology roll, please.
Ingenuity 5 and 10. 13.
You're trying to reach out to it. You're trying to attack the circuitry of this device, but you're not. It's got some sort of protection, like a firewall around the electronic mind of whatever this creature is, and it's not letting you in at the moment. It then squirrels around, squirming all over the place, and then, amazingly, although it's only about that sort of size, and it's on the floor, it leaps up about 5 foot and jumps onto the neck of the guard and is now attacking the guard. What do you do? There's the outside, you can see flashes of lightning go off on and off all the time.
I control the lightning with my technology.
No, you're not able to do that, but your interface doesn't allow you to do that.
Nice try, though. Yeah. I like it. Yeah. Yeah. I like the bold thinking.
Around what you can see, looking around in the room, you can see the four-poster bed that the lady-in-waiting was sleeping on. You can also see her drawing table, and she's got, amongst other things, a very plain silver tiara. She has a rather ostentatious-looking silver comb, and she also has a powder as well, with a puff for applying her makeup. She has various lotions and potions as well, and she also has a panoply of various costumes and dresses. In the where it's raining and windy, the window, the small window with the lead framework that it's encased in, suddenly flashes open in the wind, and the wind is now coming into the room.
I'm not quite sure what to do.
That's all right. That's role playing. You're role playing somebody who does. That's fine. That's absolutely fine. Add on one story point. Have you taken off any story points?
Not yet, no.
No, okay. Well, add one on anyway for good role playing. Because you're playing somebody who's confused and doesn't know what to do. I like it. So, the creature has been worrying at the neck of the guard, and then it springs off again, and it's now scurrying around all over the floor, coming towards you. What do you do?
You've got loads of stuff on the table, remember? Something like on there.
Attack it with the tiara.
Okay, all right. Make a strength plus fighting roll, please.
10.
10? It wriggles away. You're trying to bash it with its tiara, and it just scurries away. It's really quick.
Think about what else you've got on there. It's electronic. Is there anything on there that you might not go over the electronics?
A silver cone? Are you having a look around?
Yeah.
Okay, make an ingenuity plus survival roll.
13.
Okay, you're looking around, and there's a coat stand in one corner, and extraordinarily, it's made of metal. It's made of copper. It's about 6 foot high. It's a wooden central staff, but to make it look decorative, it's coated in copper. It must be enormously expensive. More lightning outside.
I use it to not control the lightning, but conduct the lightning to
aim it towards the thing?
No, to end the actual thing that I'm trying to kill.
Yeah, so you're trying to use it to conduct the lightning into the thing and kill it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Sorry. All right. So, do you want to describe? Okay, you pick up the coat stand, the copper coated coat stand, and you put one end out of the window, and you've got the other end like this. This creature, whatever it is coming towards you. Make an ingenuity plus technology roll.
Do you want to come out?
15.
Just as the side mat is going to leap off the ground in front of you, a bolt of lightning hits the other end of the copper coat stand, flashes down the copper coat stand, and zaps this creature. And with a loud pop sound, it blows out the circuitry in the creature. It kind of hops up and then falls flat down on its back, dead, lifeless.
Yay.
Okay, so Mary Seton and the guard are still lying very much in pain and discomfort from being attacked.
So where is the doctor at this point?
They're off out doing whatever.
So not anywhere near
me. Nope, it's down to you, mate.
So I can't get them to help me.
Nope, it's down to you, my friend.
So set the scene of where the guys are again?
Pardon me?
Set the scene of where we are.
Where everyone is in this room for them.
Right, okay. So you are in the bedchamber of the lady-in-waiting. Mary Seton, the lady-in-waiting, is collapsed near her four-poster bed, lying on the ground in great pain. The wound where she is bitten has some blood seeping from it. And as you watch, it's starting to go to have a bit of a green tinge to it. And the same thing is happening to the guardsman, although the guardsman is rather nearer the door to the chamber, lying on the ground. There is this now singed and wisping body of this metallic rat lying on its back, dead to the world as well. A small flame flickers up from one end of it, near its mouth.
Right, so I would...
And as you're watching, suddenly you hear another yell from a different part of the castle. Ah! Sorry, Benny. That alarmed him then. That was good role playing, Benny.
Yeah, we need to go check it out.
Okay. So you're by yourself at the moment.
Well, I need to go check it out then.
Sure. Okay. You're walking out and you run down the corridor. It's in the Baron's council chamber. And there are two guards with spears stood either side of one of these creatures. And the creature is sort of looking around. Make an awareness plus survival roll.
Oh. Seven.
As you're watching, you can see on one of the large curtains that hangs down from one side of the wall, one of these creatures is actually scurrying up the carpet, up the wall. So there's two of them that you can see. Okay, meanwhile, back with you two. So, Orla, you come round. You're in huge pain. Your whole body feels... your whole body feels as though you've had a serious shock. All your nerve endings feel numb and deadened, and you're able to get up to stagger up to your feet, but you feel really clumsy and weak.
Doctor, get into my bag.
Where's my lady?
In the words of Adam West, I have prepared an anti-pain.
Oh, your anti-pain serum.
Yeah.
I don't remember us knocking that up.
Give that to me now, quick.
Okay, I grabbed my tinctures from her bag.
And I've taken my anti-pain serum.
Jolly good. Make an ingenuity plus medicine roll, please.
And I've got 14.
Yes, you're able to apply that to yourself, and you do feel a lot better. So add on 2... points, please. It was coordination, wasn't it?
Yes.
So, yeah. So you're still a bit weary and weak, but you're a lot better than you were.
God, lucky the next day and grab the shark repellent spray from in there.
That's okay, Robin. You did fine.
We give it.
Right, so we've seen the Cybermen go off in the south.
He's long gone.
Okay, right. I think we should go back and check on No Name and then regroup. Parents.
Okay, so you're heading back into Mortonbury Village. As you do so, you see a figure, rather a short, slight figure, of a man in his late 30s. He's got black hair, bald on top, and he's wandering around in rather dishevelled-looking brown robing. He has a wagon behind him that seems to have has two very large chests. Hello there. Two very large chests with a that are locked, and he is walking towards Mortonbury Castle very slowly because his wagon is not moving very quickly in the rain. His wagon's being pulled by two horses. He says, "Ah, strangers, are you doctors of the plague?"
"We are doctors."
"Very good.
We're a doctor and nurse at very least."
I am a healer myself. You're a Virgo, aren't you? You're a Virgo, and you are Cancer. No. You are an Aries. You are a water sign. You're Earth. You're water and Earth. What does that make?"
Mud! You two make mud! That's it, of course! Ah, that must be the answer. Ah, yes. By the way, my name is Robert.
Woo!
I am Robert. I am known in these parts as a healer.
Yes, we've heard you described in some similar terms.
Good! My reputation precedes me.
Okay, may we precede you and get on this horse and, or this carriage and get us to the castle?
You are very welcome. Yes, indeed. I'm heading to the castle myself. I'm friends with Lord Percival, you know. And, yes, so do join me. What is your name?
I'm the Doctor. This is Orla.
Very pleased to meet you. Yes, and what do you do? Your doctor's the plague, I see. Yes, very good. I had the plague myself. I had it, but I got better. I had it. I felt so hot. I woke up. My limbs were trembling. Oh, I thought this is the end. This is the end, Robert. It's come. It's come at last. The plague. You've heard so much about it, and now you're going to forfeit your death from it as well. Oh. And then I got up. I fixed myself my usual breakfast. A fried egg and a cup of, I don't know if you've heard of it, coffee. I had a cup of coffee and fried egg. And within a few hours, I felt so much better.
And
I recovered.
Are you sure you didn't have a hangover?
I might.
Did you have any of the other symptoms people have been saying about?
Which were those?
Green blood?
Well, I was coughing a bit of green phlegm, yes.
Was this?
I was a bit sick.
Had you been drinking the night before, Robert?
Only my usual tipple.
Which is?
A bit of maggot's mead.
How much maggot's mead did you have?
A couple of goblets.
Right, I think we've solved that little conundrum there.
I diagnose you with a hangover, Robert.
Oh, I see. Well, very well. Yes. Well, yes, I'm a bit of an apothecarist myself, and I have all sorts of things here. I have a rabbit's paw. That's good for everything, you know. That brings you
good luck. Not good for the rabbit.
No, admittedly. No, it's not. But we won't say it was a very tasty rabbit. Mm. It's very lucky for me. Not so much for the rabbit. It's very lucky for the rabbit.
Right, snap out of it, Bob. Let's get back to the house.
Yes, of course, yes. Well, there we are. Have you ever tried coffee? It's marvellous, you know. I got it from a merchant who had received it from Arabia, the land of Arabia itself.
Mm. Yeah. Was this the Costa brothers who were selling it?
Yes, that was his name.
Anyway, I believe these are your famed horses, Benton and Dotty.
Yes. That's right.
So you have to roll anything.
I should take Dotty.
Okay.
Who knows where we might end up with Benton.
Benton? Oh, Benton's trying to shoot the side of the castle.
Yes.
It was I that saw the shooting star that led to the plague. Off to the south it was. I think it landed in Hawksford.
We should go investigate Hawksford.
Okay, well, we're going to go back to Castle right now, then we're going to go on to Hawksford. Which direction does Hawksford lie?
To the south. Hawksford Castle.
Mutter, 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 mutter.
Lord Tristan is the Earl of Hawksford. Hawksford, and his domain is Hawksford Castle.
Okay, make a note of that, please, Will. Hawksford Castle.
All is your secretary now, isn't she?
I know, PA. How'd you like your coffee?
Coffee, you say?
Yeah, teacups, please.
Yes, I make poultices for the men. I do my very best to try and help them as much as I can.
I don't need a poultice. What have you heard?
Just for the men?
Just for men? To turn their hair black?
Well, women are too a penny, are they not? It's men that we need. If they attack Mortonbury Castle, it is going to be men that we need, not women, isn't it?
Mm. Might win a battle with men, win a war with a woman. Just saying.
I'd know, I find it very hard to win a war with a woman.
Exactly, so you know who...
Your assistant has some very peculiar ideas, doesn't she?
I usually go by companion these days.
Oh. Mm. Oh, it's like that, is it?
Radical.
Are you not married?
Anyway, let's go to the castle. No hanky-panky aboard the TARDIS.
I think you need some celery. That's what a man like you needs. You need a stalk of celery to carry around with you at all times. That'll be the thing to keep noxious vapours at bay. Here, I have the very thing.
I did that look so many years ago.
The rain's stopped by now. He goes into one of his large chests and he's tinkering around. And Orla, you can see inside, he has all sorts of equipment, supplies, all manner of tools, lots of different bits of equipment, all sorts of things. Anyway, he reaches, here we are, there. And he tries to give it to you. That's what you need, I think. Yes, all my years of experience. And he gets a little book. Yes, here we are, yes. That's exactly what a man of your size and age should have. I can see it in your stars.
I take the celery, throw it over my shoulder. I'm sorry, it's just not cricket these days.
Very well. Off to Mortonbury Castle. Okay, so you head off to Mortonbury Castle. When you get in, it is absolute pandemonium everywhere. There are people screaming in terror. A guard comes over to you and says, Doctor, you've got to do something. Your young man there, he saved the lady in waiting. There's these creatures crawling everywhere. It's an epidemic, I tell you. We're infested.
Do I happen to recognise them as cybermats?
You haven't actually seen one so far.
Oh, okay.
But what you can hear is men shouting in the council chamber, the Lord Percival's council chamber. What are you doing in the council chamber? So you've seen these two creatures. What
these
are you
doing? Creatures, I used the crit stand again.
Okay.
Because I think one was on the wall.
Mm-hmm.
I knocked it off the wall.
Yep.
And try and attack it as much as I can.
Sure.
And if like when it runs away,
mm-hmm.
and I start to follow it.
Okay. Yeah, it's able to nip a new out of your way at all times.
Nip a new?
Indeed. It's a technical term.
Nice work, buddy.
Thank you. A bit of alliteration never helps.
Yeah.
Alliteration always amazing, I always think.
Mm-hmm.
So, yes. So you're giving chase to one of these creatures when the Doctor and Orla walk into the main council chamber. You're walking around, so yes, you can see. There's a cybermat on the floor that is worrying these two guards, and you also see No Name running around after one of these creatures that is scurrying up and down the castle. Up and down the carpet that is, like a lot of castles, it's got a large piece of carpet.
Tapestry.
Yes, please, that'll do. on one wall as decoration. And he's trying to get at it, but it seems to be scurrying away. What do you do?
Okay,
Robert is meanwhile unloading one of his chests into the corridor outside the main chamber. I must have something that deals with this. I must. What do you do?
I take the tapestry from the wall, try and wrap it around the side mat to sonic it to interfere with the signal.
Okay. To wrap the side mat up, first of all, can you make a coordination plus fighting roll, please?
9, 16.
You're just able to do it. It's really wriggling for its life, but you are able to wrap it up in the tapestry. Next round. So, okay. Right, let's go into proper rounds then. So, Orla, what are you doing this round? You don't have to do anything. You could just be stood there in shock, potentially. It wouldn't be a bad role-playing thing.
I assist you with the carpet.
So she's helping stabilise it. Yeah, that's nice.
That's great. Special rule point here, you can help each other, and if you do, the person who actually rolls gets a plus two to whatever they're rolling on. Okay?
So that plus two, does it subjugate a bit more?
So are you using your sonic? So you're using your sonic at this point?
Yeah, if I can, but she was steadying it, so I take it that applies to the first action that I did.
At this point, you don't have to worry about keeping the thing trapped in the tapestry as much because Orla is helping you do
Perfect.
That. So you can concentrate using your sonic.
Brilliant.
No, I'm not rolling at the moment, we're just talking about statements of intent. Sounds like a rune quest term. Okay, and No Name, what are you doing?
What am I doing? So the one I was chasing after, has that been caught?
That's the one that the Doctor has caught. There's still the one that's between the two guards.
Right, so I go back to the guards and try and attack the other one that's right in front of the guards so they can help me a little bit with, like, chasing it if it runs away.
Yep.
That's what I'm going to do.
Okay, cool, good. All right, so I think doers first. So, Doctor.
Okay, so what do I need to do for the stomach again?
Ingenuity plus technology.
Ingenuity 9 plus technology 5, so 14, 15, 16, 17, 18.
Okay. It works. Do you want to describe what happens?
Well, I sonic it, being the technical term. It disrupts its signal and it switches off.
Yeah.
Like Danny when I'm holding him in my arms and he just like lies back.
Yeah. It deactivates and goes lifeless.
That's the word.
Lifeless.
So in the meantime, at the same time, no name. You're chasing after. You're trying to assist the guards with this particular creature that's on the ground. It's squaring around, and then suddenly it flings itself at you. Right. Okay. Can you roll coordination plus fighting, please?
Coordination.
Let me see here. Oh, here we are. Yeah.
An 11.
It's got you. It leaps. It's scurrying around on the floor, and then it leaps 6 foot into the air, comes at you, bitten into your neck. Okay, right, next round. So, Orla, what are you doing this round?
I am going to assist No Name, I think, because you have got it under control with the carpet.
Right, everyone's dead. It's gone.
Yeah. So I'm going to go and assist No Name.
Okay, No Name, what are you doing?
Being in a lot of pain. I'm going to be in a lot of pain after being bitten.
You are. Definitely.
Screaming on the floor. Bawling my eyes out.
I have a hypodermic needle in my first aid kit, which actually paralyses, and I will paralyze the creature.
All right. Okay. And sorry, Doctor, what are you doing?
Right, what I'm going to do is, again, because I've used the sonic to already hack its neural network,
mm-hmm.
I'm going to use it to try and send a signal through the deactivated cybermat to the active ones to disrupt the signal. So, like, you know, basically use the same technique through it to send a signal up to all its brethren to in radius to switch off.
Okay. You know that's going to be a very challenging thing to do.
Okay, I will just use it to
for the. I'm not saying it's impossible, I'm just saying it's going to be tricky.
I tell you what, I will use it to send that signal to the closest one.
Okay, that's cool. That makes it a little bit easier. Right, okay, this round, the side mat is basically going to be biting you.
Right.
It's pretty simple, pretty straightforward. Okay, so, right, firstly, it's going to be the doers, so Orla. So can you describe what you're doing?
Yeah, I'm reaching into my first aid kit, which is like Mary Poppins' bag. And I have got hypodermic needle, which will paralyze the creature, and I'm running towards No Name.
Okay, all right. Try your ingenuity plus medicine, please.
I've got 11.
Okay, you have got, in your kit, you have got a very powerful, effectively, knockout drug that would put out an elephant, potentially.
Yeah.
You stick it into the side mat.
Yep.
While it's worrying on No Name's neck. Doesn't have any effects. It's not organic, so it doesn't work on it. Right, and No Name. So you're being bitten at the moment.
Yeah.
Okay, roll for your coordination plus fighting, please.
13.
What's that noise, sir?
TV.
Oh, that's a bard from the
Mortonbury
Castle.
Yes.
I think I'm just going to go and tell him to shut up.
it's not disturbing me, I just wondered.
No, I might as well switch it off. I think we might be left on for the dogs, but they joined us. So.
All right, okay. And very good company they are as well, wherever they are.
One over there.
So, what did you get, Nene?
13.
Okay, take off. It's fitting into you. Take off 3 points of strength. What's your strength?
Two.
Two. I think it is, yeah. So, yeah, you're unconscious on the ground.
Yay.
Take off 1 point of coordination as well. You are okay. You see No Name buckle and fall to the floor, and this thing is still attacking you. Doctor, using your sonic.
So, ingenuity
plus technology.
I'm up that wonder. People at home are shouting that at their viruses.
That's all right.
14, 15, 18.
18. Cool. Okay. Right, okay, just bear with me a minute. Presence. Okay. Sorry, what did you roll?
18.
Yeah, you're easily able to overpower it with the signal. And the side of the mat that was worrying No Name, that was attacking No Name, falls to the ground, lifeless, deactivated as well. But No Name is still unconscious on the floor. Mm-hmm. So what do you do?
Again, using the sonic, I know it's a cheap trick, but I'm going to try and scan to see what the damage is, like if it's organic or if it's mechanical, given his internet history.
Sure. So, ingenuity plus technology, please.
22.
Very good. Okay, you have surpassed yourself with your skills with the sonic screwdriver in yielding information. And what you discover is that this high level of iron and sulfur is already washing into No Name's body and being circulated around his body through his blood. And what you also discover is that the interface that he has, which in your with your Time Lord technology is very, to you, it's a very straightforward cybernetic implant. But what you discover is that there's some form of alien software, some form of alien virtual living thing, living life form, has started to integrate itself into the interface as well. So it's as if No Name's whole being is being attacked by cyber technology in on two fronts as a result. So it's very worrying, in conclusion.
Yep. So is that a request of what action I'm doing next?
No, I'm just saying.
Okay.
Okay. In the meantime, while this has all been going on, Robert comes back in with one of these creatures in his hands.